So today, I'm going to talk about my own story, but through that, I'd love you to discover your own as well. I'm from an organization called Buy One, Give One, which is a global giving initiative, and we work with businesses around the world and help them give back in meaningful ways. So one of the examples was that by you today, you know, just being here, many girls, disadvantaged girls in Cambodia, receiving tuition sessions so that they can pass exams and stay in school. Related to that, actually, there is so much more in the depths of this story, because when the girls actually quit school because they fail exams, or their families couldn't afford buying school materials and so on, then what end up happening is that many of these girls get sent out and they go into sex trade, human trafficking, and so this vulnerability that they have, through the things, simple things like just giving them extra tuition sessions, or giving them books, or helping them with their uniform and so on, can really transform this. But there are so many little parts that are involved in making great impact and great change and difference. So it may not be that one thing can solve all of the problems in the world, but what if every small thing can come together to create a great, long-lasting impact? And you being here today is a start. So now, today, Buy One, Give One exists to create a world full of giving. But I'm not going to talk too much about it, because you're going to discover that through the story itself. We're going to talk about creating the maximum impact in a new meaning-driven world today. What does it mean? What world are we part of today? So please follow through. And this is a journey. And every journey that we experience, initially, this is what happens. In the great scale of the world, we feel so small. You know, our individual personal impact seems to be so small. So what we do at an individual level doesn't seem to make much of a difference. You know, what if I choose not to throw away rubbish, but everybody else is doing it? What difference does it make? So there is this personal impact that we create every day. Then the next thing is the social impact that we have. Why is it that you turn up at this festival today instead of going shopping in the mall? Maybe you had some people around you who influenced you for having the consciousness or awareness. Or, you know, your choices today, the choices you make today are determined by so many different conditions. So in the social interactions that we have every day, we are driving our social impact in different ways. So what if we could maximize our personal impact, learn to maximize our personal impact, and we learn to maximize our social impact, so we create the community around us of those people who care. And finally, the last part is the enterprise impact, whether you are a business owner or you are part of a company, you know, you are an employee working in a team, or you may work for an NGO. So wherever you are being part of this enterprise, you know, creating the enterprise impact as an organization and team. So what if we also learn to maximize our enterprise impact? Then this wave of impact spread and create amazing difference. So as I think of an example, the example is like this. Stephanie and Gerald, who founded Wedge Asia and then founded this Conscious Festival, they are example of two people who started up with individuals and went to school to learn and traveled and met many people. And then as a result, they became who they are today. Then what happened was, you know, maybe their values or beliefs or choices that they make may have been a result of the people they spend the time with. But then their social impact eventually led them to found this business and the festival. And look at the people around you and all the people downstairs and all the people who have businesses that they wanted to showcase, having the opportunity to be here today, to connect with you. So just by one person maximizing the personal impact and social impact, And then enterprise impact, actually, they can transform so many lives. And imagine, as a part of you being here, you go home and do something different. And that impact is spreading across as a result of Stephanie and Gerald's personal impact, social impact, and enterprise impact. So I hope you will find that wave of impact and learn how you're going to maximize that impact through the journey we're going to take today. When we think about the journey and then the story that brings the journey, quite often what happens is we think we are about to go and find an answer or go and see something, you know, as a part of taking the trip. But then often what happens through traveling is that we discover it wasn't really about the destination or it wasn't really about the thing that we thought we were going to explore. But often the deepest experience and learning and the inspiration that we gain through those journeys that we have is this. It's the change in our perspective, having a new set of eyes to see the world in different ways. Let me tell you my story, because in the great scheme of things, I felt very, very small. So I'm the one, the two girls on the ground. I'm not the auntie there, but the smaller one, that's me. I grew up in Japan. We are sitting in front of a grandparent's shop in Tokyo. And that's what they did. They had their own small business. They were connected with the community. And I grew up spending quite a lot of time during school holidays to go and spend time with my grandparents, because I loved being with them and being in their place, because they had a family business. And I used to serve customers, and I used to stock up things and, you know, sweep the street in front of the shop every day. And so by doing that, I think I gained a lot of learning about being in business, you know, particularly in small business. But then I felt very, very small, because my parents got married at young age. My father came from a rural part of Japan, and he didn't have a good education. He had six siblings, and because of that, his family couldn't afford him to go to university, and he went up to Tokyo to get a job. In the corporate world, he had to work really, really hard. You know, in Japan, so many people commit suicide. That's the kind of reality with all the stress and pressure. So he was hardly ever at home when I was growing up. And when he was at home, he was always quite angry, drunk. So growing up in that environment and me being a very, very shy child, I didn't know how to express myself. I tried not to be somebody who upset my parents, so I couldn't speak in front of people. So it's amazing that I can speak in front of you today without feeling any fear at all. And I didn't speak English too. Within that environment, I started to wonder, why is it that we were trying so hard to get something, like whether it is to have more money or a better status in the company. But in the family, I felt quite insecure. So when I grew up, and I one day decided to go on traveling, and I didn't speak English, and I couldn't speak with strangers properly, even in Japan, but I decided to go alone with my backpack, and I traveled around the world. And I spent a few years traveling and visiting places, meeting people, working, you know, doing volunteer work, hitchhiking. I did everything I could to connect and experience whatever was happening. And it was amazing, because I realized that the reason why I wasn't able to speak or I wasn't able to express myself wasn't because I didn't have words. I wasn't confident, or it was just that when I lost everything, when I didn't have any word to communicate myself, like express myself, because I couldn't speak English, then suddenly I could connect with people. Because there are people out there who saw me, and when I was in trouble, even though I didn't have much, people came to help me. If you could smile, if you try to help people, give back, connect, then opportunities are out there, and people are very kind and warm. So I realized that actually the world wasn't a scary place at all. And then, as I did that, I started to see something else. I started to see these pictures of distractions and problems. And when I was spending a lot of time in countries like Asia, you know, India, or Central America, I lived in Guatemala for 3 years. Like, the everyday reality was that you would see people living on the street. It was a normal reality. And you would see kids begging on the street or sleeping on the street in the cold winter night. And I could not believe, like, why, like, in my country, in Japan, people are having so much, even though, you know, I come from a middle-class family, and our family wasn't a wealthy family. But still, we had food to eat, clothes to wear, place to be, and I could go to school. But in those parts of the world, there are still many people who weren't fulfilled and being happy. But then at the same time, if you go to other parts of the world, you then suddenly start to see people who have nothing. And why can we allow young kids like that to be sleeping on the street? And I could not understand. It just didn't make sense to me. But then I realized that because I was so small and I couldn't change the world, so I made up my mind to just enjoy the experience, connect with people, and I went home. Let me just tell you a story. So this is where I ended up in. So, because I realized that maybe the source of all evils, all the problems that were happening in the world, and environmental challenges and so on, was because of the consumerism. So that's what I thought. Then I thought, then maybe I should stop buying anything. So I decided to create a 100% self-sufficient life by going to a countryside and to learn to grow all my food and, you know, not to have waste and so on. So I went to an old community in Japan, 4 hours drive away from my hometown, and then ended up there. I worked for local farmers who were doing organic farming. And, you know, every day I learned so much working together with the people in this simple, simple community. And we grew our own food and, you know, we learned to bake our own pottery or, you know, make preserved food or and anything we needed. Most of those things we just learned to exchange with each other. But then after 2 years of doing that and learning about how things worked in the, you know, really, really natural way, suddenly something dawned on me. And I was really, really happy because being part of this community to me was like a security because, you know, being there, you know that if something goes wrong, people are there to help you. And you know that because you know that you're going to go and help anybody in that community who have problems. And because of that commitment you have, you also know that everybody else is there to help you. And that kind of makes you feel totally connected and secure. But then one day it dawned on me that actually all the things I felt was wrong, like we shouldn't buy this or we shouldn't throw this away. And I was like really judging what was going on in the world. One day I just realized that actually we are all the same. When I was traveling around the world, and I had not much, but the people there had much less. But at that point of time, we could connect. And the people who are more, you know, well-to-do, but these people actually cared. And it was my judgment, you know, that drove me to try to find the right answer to solving the problem. And to me, it was to disconnect from the world by not buying things. But I realized I was wrong because even in the countryside, I still had to connect with the world. I was still driving a car because that's how I got to the field. I still used the tools because you cannot keep digging, you know, the ground with my hand. And I realized that because of all the people who came up with the ideas to solve our problem, to make our life more efficient, more rewarding, and more effective and nurturing. That's why I could exist, so I had no right to judge. Now, after having this perspective, I started to see things again quite differently too. I realized from the farmers, you know, of Japan, who are doing farming for hundreds of years as a family, there was some like wisdom that I could learn. And one of the wisdom was this. So there are two cycles that we had in terms of creating abundance in our life, because we all exist and do what we do to have things, whether to have experience or whether to go and buy something or eat yummy food, or, you know, we like having things. But there are two ways to do this. One of those ways is starting from the direction of getting. You know, people said like we have to be go-getters, go and get it. So we try to get something we want to have, and then we have it. But then after we have that thing, whether the latest fashion piece that we wanted to have, or the movie that we wanted to watch, or so whatever that is, we experience that having, but as a result of getting. But quite often, what happens is this. And I put to this quote, losing. It's not that you really lose it all the time, but what happens is the moment you have it, the thing you thought you really wanted to have, kind of like becomes less exciting because you already have it. So you might lose the interest, or you might actually lose it. You spend so much money buying it, but it's broken and you now need to fix it, and then you don't want to fix it, so you throw it away. So the angle of trying to get things often result in this cycle. And then there's another cycle, which starts from having. So you recognize you actually do have something, whether you have time to give, or you have, you know, something, you already have a happy family, or you start from having. And then the next thing you do is to find a way to give, find a way to, you know, help others, or if you want to be loved, what about starting from having, you know, feeling loved and feeling lots of love and give the love, find a way to give love. Then as a result, you end up receiving. And then the cycle goes on. So the first one is actually the deficient cycle, and then the second one is the sufficient cycle, because underlying feeling within these cycles, one of the cycles, you're always feeling that you don't have enough. You need to get more. And the other cycle is like you're always feeling fulfilled and grateful that you have enough, but you will go and find a way to give actively, and as a result, having more. So if you are to choose one of these cycles, which cycles do you want to live your life with? And I think more people would say the second one, I hope. So now I was back in the city and looking around, and this was the world I really judged, you know, before I went to the country. And then after having that thought, like a shift in the mindset, I realized, and it looked like something like this. I realized that the farmers did years and years, hundreds of years, or thousands of years, was that they were always giving back to the soil, putting things back in so that the next year they would have the harvest. And not only next year, they can have the harvest hundreds of years time when their children become farmers and need food. Bees do exactly that. Years after years, the season of flowering, they go around and collect nectar. But when they collect the nectar, automatically, at the same time, they give back. And then next season, flowers are back. But in human society, what we started to do was to kind of avoid pollination and, you know, like try to skip it so that you can suck out as much as you can to gain more in the short term, knowing that when you continue to do so, then next year, maybe we don't have as many flowers. So it's very, very simple. Now, when you look at some of the research, and again, you would notice that actually the world is changing. Fortunately, the world is changing. So 84% is the percentage of people seeking responsible products in today's world. And that comes from world's nine biggest economy. And 10,000 people participated in this research. And then the second one, 78% of people want to work for more companies that's good in the world. So actually, so many of us already have the desire to purchase things that are good for the world and want to have a purposeful job and work that makes a difference in the world. So if so many of us are wanting to do this, then why is it that we cannot do that much, much more than what we are doing today? Looking at, you know, back to this city and then the world of business, now in this world where so many people are wanting to buy more socially responsible products or socially responsible work, then the businesses actually need to shift. And because that's the way we as businesses can thrive too. So we came through the focus of profit-driven model, that the making the profit, and especially the short-term profit, was the key to our success. That's how we evaluate our business. Now we need to shift to the next step, to be more purpose-driven, because that's the only way to really create the positive change. So it's not just that you would kind of, you know, as we discussed earlier, make our mission sounds like we are doing a good thing. So if, for example, a company, start producing organic product just because, oh, there's a market, more people are buying that. So by making it organic or labeling as socially responsible, will make people buy more. And as a result, we can make more money. If that's the intention, it's not really purpose-driven, because then as a result, the real positive change would not happen. So let me talk a bit more. Already things are happening. You know, if you look at all the information available, then you see that the shift in the stories that we hear and the stories that we tell. It seems like there is this underlying movement that the businesses and organizations are looking at the purpose already. What often we see with the numbers and statistics is like, for example, how many children are dying with lack of sanitation every day, every minute. And when we see, and that's the reality, but the thing is, when we see these numbers in a way that is overwhelming, what we tend to do is to disconnect from that, because we cannot fix those problems, and I don't want to feel, or you don't want to feel, just bad about what's going on and feel negative and horrible and depressed about the world. That's not what we want to do. So through the work we do, we see things actually quite differently. So let me show you different set of numbers today to shift your. $22 billion is the amount of extra funding required to give access to basic education to all the children in developing countries, right? So these numbers are indication, like you can go and find that out in places like Global Issues, but these are just the indications, because depending on how those work is delivered, the cost would change. But let's say this is an example, $22 billion. And then the next one, $23 billion is the amount of extra funding required to give access to water and sanitation to the people in developing countries. Third one, $30 billion is the amount of funding that's required to give nourishing meals, nutrition, basic nutrition to the children in developing countries. Right. So these are the numbers. And can I see show of hand who can fix those problems? No? Okay. So the next number, set of numbers. Okay. The next one. $168 billion is the size of, it's okay, don't worry. The $168 billion is the size of publishing industry. I put it next to the education, requirement, right? And then the next one, $1 trillion is the size of pharmaceutical industry. The third one, $568 billion is the size of fast food industry in our world. Now, when we see it in this context, we start seeing something different. Because these industries are only a small part of what we actually have in our world. publishing industry isn't the only industry related to education. So what about all the businesses around the world if they had the purpose-driven approach? Isn't that be very, very actually easy to fix so many pressing issues that we feel overwhelming? Seeing the picture of the potential, real potential of businesses, in 2006, I imagined. So now I want you to imagine with me. Imagine every time you had a cup of coffee or a favorite herbal tea or a drink. Somebody in need received access to life-saving water for one day. Imagine that, every time. And imagine every time you purchased a book and learned something, a tree gets planted. Imagine every time you went to see a doctor, child in need received health care. Imagine that world. And so that's the world of buy one, give one. So with the world of buy one, give one, we realized that if we could work with businesses to embed giving in what they did, then we could actually make such huge difference. And we realized that there are three things we can create: impact, habit, and connection. Now, let me show you how that works. So the next one is the model of B1G1. So what happens is when businesses work with us and choose the project they want to support, or projects, you know, because businesses might want to give back to so many different causes, then they become part of B1G1 initiative as members like Wedge Asia, and 100% of what they give gets passed to the causes. And then Buy One, Give One also provide businesses their report on the impact or tools and resources to make the business giving meaningful for their team members and possibly their customers as well. This is B1G1's project listing. If you zoom in a bit more, so the next one shows you just zooming in, you can see we have more than 800 projects listed in B1G1, and you realize how easy it is to actually make a tangible impact. Next one. And businesses can create things like, we call it their giving story. So they can find a way to embed giving in their activities. Every time we complete a project, then we want to educate a child. Or every time we sell one of our products, then we want to plant a tree or give access to water and so on. This is the way the impact gets displayed after businesses are giving. So everything they give, every dollar and then cents that they are giving, becomes a specific impact and we count it real time. And today we have so many businesses working with B1G1, and we have more than 1,600 businesses today, supporting over 800 projects listed on our platform. And these businesses have created more than 88 million giving impacts, but as of today, it's changed to 89 million because we passed that next milestone. Thank you. So this is my why. Please meet somebody special. She's my daughter, Myra. she was born 15 years ago. And at that time, when I became a mom for the first time and I saw her face, I realized that I just loved her so much and I could do anything for her. You know, I would give her everything. But a few days later, with that overwhelming experience and the feeling of love, suddenly something dawned on me. I started to see the faces of children I met when I was traveling. And I thought, I would be committed to give everything for my daughter. But what about other kids? What happened to them? They are still living on the street and they still cannot go to school. And I cannot change the world. But if I cared so much about my daughter, then maybe I should do just a little bit more than just feeding my family and supporting them. So that's how I went into business. I went into food business myself because I believed in food and I learned to cook as well. So that was my business. And I had a gluten-free, organic frozen meal range product in Australia. And I was running that business for more than 5 years when I realized that as a small business owner, we get so busy, you know, we don't have a lot of time. And my mission was to one day go and give a profit so that we could help build a soup kitchen and feed and educate a lot of kids. So that was the intention and the mission. But then 5 years later, when our business was expanding, we were still in the same place because we were still putting money back to grow the business, buy new equipment and packaging and so on. So it felt like our goal was moving together, you know, with us, and we were never going to get there. But then the idea of buy one, give one came to us. We realized that instead of trying to do big thing, what if we broke down that big thing into a small thing and did it today? So if every time we sold a packet of meal and already fed a child, then that already makes a difference. So making a difference could be part of what we did every day rather than having an ambitious big goal in the future. And then I realized that it wasn't just us who felt like that. There were so many business owners who started their business because they believed in something, but they've forgotten because they get so busy. They've forgotten that they could make a small impact today and make a positive difference today. So we launched Buy One, Give One as a global giving initiative to help businesses. And that was 9 years ago. And today, we are really grateful to have people like Wedge, you know, businesses like Wedge Asia giving back through this conscious community, but also so many other businesses that make a difference. So through the thing that we do with Buy One, Give One, when we see these pictures again, we don't feel overwhelmed because we see something else. We see that these pictures, the things we saw was simply an opportunity. Every single thing that we see is an opportunity for us to make a difference. And with Buy One, Give One, businesses around the world are doing that, involving their customers and the communities. So you can see that. And by 2020, so right now we are 89 million giving impact. And so we aim to hit 1 billion impact by 2020. And it's an ambitious goal, but we believe that with everybody, you know, seeing your face here, and then also seeing all the businesses being part of this conscious festival, which wouldn't have been possible many years ago, we believe that businesses and individuals with a real sense of purpose really can transform our world through the power of small. By making giving habit and making a difference habit and having that sense of purpose and mission, but appreciating the small things that we do every day, we together can change our world. So thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to share.